Good morning. Hey, welcome to our service this morning. We're delighted to see everybody here this morning. That's great. There is no live stream this morning, but for those of you that are watching it later on YouTube, you're welcome to, and we're glad that you've joined us, and we trust that as we worship God together, you would sense his presence as we praise and glorify his name. A few announcements I have for you this morning. First of all, Janet Mabee has asked if we would pray for her mother. Apparently, she's in the hospital. I think it's pneumonia and maybe some other complications. So in your time of prayer, please remember Janet's mom. Next weekend, our youth are part of a retreat, and we'd encourage you to pray for our young folks as they go on this retreat. And if you are interested in or know somebody who might want to go, you'll find in the bulletin an email address. You can contact Jeff to join to find out more about it. On the 28th, which is a week this coming Tuesday, is our annual general meeting, 7 o'clock here at the church, and I encourage all to come. It's an important part of the business of the church that that particular event and that we partake of it, as many as can. The events of this week, and I'm sorry this is a little long, but Tobias didn't get this week in St. Paul's. It's in the e-news, but it's not in your bulletin. So she's asked me if I would just quickly flag for you. Things are as you normally expect on Tuesday, the St. Paul's play group, the ladies' Bible study, and the knitting circle is meeting. Thursday, the men's Bible study, the pastoral care meeting, and the choir practice are taking place. So, Grant will be back with us next Sunday. We hope charged, recharged, and refreshed. And on behalf of Session, I just want to thank particularly Shaharzad and Jeffrey and Tabia, who have done so much in making sure there's just been really, I don't want to say Grant isn't missed, that would be rather inappropriate, but that things work service, the ministry and the work of the church continue during that time. So thanks to all who participated in that. As we come to worship God now, let's just take a moment, just bow our heads, prepare our hearts to and we praise our wonderful God. So let's just take a moment. In Psalm 130, the psalmist invites us to put our hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself has redeemed us from our sins. Let's come and worship God this morning, and let's begin by joining in the singing of hymn number 76, O Worship the King.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Let's bow our heads as we come before God. Almighty God, as we come to worship you this morning, we acknowledge your measureless might, your ineffable love. Lord, you are our shield and our defender, our Savior and our Lord. We come this morning to offer praise and adoration to you, our wonderful mercy God, merciful God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And as we gather this morning, Lord, remove from our minds the accomplishments and the frustrations of this past week, and the challenges and the expectations of this coming week. Help us to bow before you with hearts of thanks and praise, that we might worship you in spirit and in truth. We ask this in our Savior's name. Amen. We continue to worship God with our responsive reading, which is Psalm number 42. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me all day long, "Where is your God?" These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One, with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. My soul is downcast within me, therefore I will remember you from the land of the Jordan, the heights of Hermon, from Mount Mizar, deep, calls too deep in the roar of your waterfalls. All your waves and breakers have swept over me. By day, the Lord directs his love. At night, his song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? My bones suffer mortal agony as my foes taunt me, saying to me all day long, "Where is your God?" Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Amen. As we continue to worship the Lord, let's turn the singing of the hymn As the Deer. Please be seated. And let's bow our head as we once again continue to pray to the Lord. Lord, as we come to learn from your word, we would ask that your spirit would move in our hearts this morning. For you alone, loving Father and gracious Savior, blessed Holy Spirit, are our heart's desire, and we long to worship you. We ask that your Holy Spirit would be with us, that we may hear, that we may understand, that we may apply the message that you have given to us this morning, you have given through Ian to us this morning, Lord. Gracious Father, may the songs we sing, may the words that Ian brings, and may the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you. We ask in the name of our precious Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you, choir. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Exodus 33, reading verses 12 to 23. Let us hear the word of God. Moses said to the Lord, You have been telling me, lead these people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. You have said, I know you by name, and you have found favor with me. If you are pleased with me, teach me your ways, so that I may know you and continue to find favor with you. Remember that this nation is your people. The Lord replied, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. Then Moses said to him, if your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth? And the Lord said to Moses, I will do the very thing you have asked, because I am pleased with you, and I know you by name. Then Moses said, show me your glory. The Lord said, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. But, he said, you cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live. Then the Lord said, there is a place near me where you can stand on a rock. When my glory passes by, I will put you in the cleft in the rock and cover you with my hand until I pass by. Then I will remove my hand and you will see my back, but my face must not be seen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's continue to worship God with the singing of hymn number 232, Fairest Lord Jesus.
Jesus, Lord, our God. you'll forgive me perhaps if I speak a little more personally this morning than I usually do. When you're in hospital, you have lots of time. And when you're in hospital for any period of time, you really have lots of time. And you get thinking. And some of the thinking is not good. And some of it is good. And some of it takes you pretty deep. And the more serious your situation, the deeper you go in your thinking. And I must say that that's been my experience. And I got thinking a lot about Paul's reflections on life and death. Now, Paul says a whole lot of things about the Christian life, and he says a fair bit about death in the sense of our hope in the resurrection. But on a couple of occasions, Paul speaks pretty bluntly about his own situation and his preference for dying over living. The first one is in Philippians chapter 2, where he writes, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account." And he goes on. He is pretty clear. Just so that we don't think that it's a mistake, he has written in another place in 2 Corinthians, "We walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we're at home or away, we make it our aim to please him." Well, what was I to think of this? I wrestled with this, and I thought a lot about it, and I consulted a couple of experts. I prayed about it, and I came to the conclusion that Paul is speaking personally here. He is not speaking prescriptively. He is not laying down a principle or presenting himself as a pattern for Christians. And some of you might be wiping your brow with relief. Paul is not saying that it is wrong for us to cherish the things of life, the people that we love and are attached to, the people that mean the world to us, nor the good things of this life, this beautiful earth, and the good things that it produces. So if this is not a principle, if Paul is speaking personally, what accounts for this? Well, Paul was in pretty crummy circumstances. He was, at least in his letter to the Philippians, writing from jail. He was awaiting trial. He had already suffered many persecutions and would suffer more. Life was hard. It had been hard. And he was prepared to go on serving the church and serving his Lord in ministering to the church and expanding the church, but he was just as happy. He would just as soon have packed his tent and gone to be with the Lord. Well, that's understandable, and that explains his preference. But what was I to take from his preference? Does that mean close the book and move on? Or is there something here that I should learn, that all of us should take from this reflection of Paul's on his preference for, to put it bluntly, dying rather than living? The first is his conviction, his contemplation of a life forever with the Lord. He was absolutely convinced that when this life ended, he would be with the Lord Jesus. The second was the knowledge that that conviction, that that future, rested on the sure foundation of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And along with that future came the prospect of a new creation, a new heaven and a new earth, where we will worship in unexplored, in as yet unexperienced ways, that we would worship God, and that there will be work for us to do in this new heaven and a new earth. This is a renewed creation, and we will be busy doing worthwhile things in that new creation. Paul was convinced of these things. And that is something that underlay, that is what motivated his desire to be with the Lord. And that we can take away from Paul's preference, even though it was personal. Is that all there is? Even there, it made me think, what more is Paul saying? What more can I glean from Paul's preference? And I believe, under the conviction of God's own Spirit, I came to the question, do I love the Lord Jesus for himself? Do I love the Savior, or do I just love my salvation? Do I love him for himself, or for what he has done for me? Paul loved the Lord for himself. And we have other examples. We have David in Psalm 63. And I selected Psalm 42 for our responsive reading because it has the same spirit as the deer longs, pants for streams of living water, so my soul pants for you, O God. Here is David in Psalm 63. God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Now David is in trouble. David is fleeing for his life when this psalm is written. His son Absalom has stirred up trouble and is leading a rebellion to take the throne away from David and make himself king. There is civil war in the land, and the king has had to flee. And he finds himself in the desert, and that is where he writes this psalm. And he's not sure how things will turn out. Just as you're not always sure in life or in hospital how things will turn out, But he says, your love is more important than life itself. And he writes that my soul will be satisfied as with fat and rich food, and my mouth will praise you with joyful lips when I remember you upon my bed and meditate on you in the watches of the night. You ever sleepless at night? You ever lie awake worrying? David did in that circumstance. And his soul, his heart, his mind went immediately to the Lord as the most important thing in his life. Do that in the sleepless watches of the night. Go to the Lord. And then there's Moses, about whom we read earlier. We come into the story of Moses after the episode of the golden calf, where the people have forgotten God's miraculous exploit in their release from slavery. And Moses is gone for a period of time, and out of anxiety or impatience, they turn to Aaron and say, give us something to worship. This man, Moses, has disappeared. And so Aaron constructs the golden calf, and they worship, and they revel, and they have a party in the wilderness there, and God is outraged at the insult and at the irreverence, at the blasphemy. And he threatens to judge them and wipe them out and start afresh with Moses. And Moses intercedes for the people, and God relents, and God renews the promise of the promised land. But there's this exchange between God and Moses. And Moses makes it clear that he wants from God three things. He wants God to show him his ways. And he tells God, if you don't go with us, don't take us up. Go with us to the promised land, you yourself. And then he asks, show me your glory. See, for Moses, the prize was not enough. The promised land was not the point. God was the point. He had to have God. And he knew that to be the people of Israel, they needed to have God. Do I value my salvation more than my Savior? And God is pleased with what Moses says. There's this expression from God where the language is almost intimate. The Lord said to Moses, this very thing that you have spoken, I will do for you, since you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name. He and Moses are really getting to know each other on a personal level. I know you by name. And the name is very significant. Just as Moses needed to know God's name way back at the burning bush, so God now says to Moses, I know you by name, and I can read your heart, and I know what's important to you, and this really pleases me. This makes me happy. And then Moses asks God, show me your glory. And any time I have studied Moses, and again, in these days, I ask myself, are you really ready for God to show you his glory? But God says to Moses something very interesting. The aspects of his glory that he will show Moses is his goodness. I will cause my goodness to pass by you. And the beginning point of his goodness is his mercy and his compassion. Now there's more. We sang some of those things. His canopy space, how he rides on the wings of the storm. God is frightful, but he is gentle. That too is his glory. And we're invited to want more of it. Well, if Paul and if David and if Moses speaks to us, as they have spoken to me, that I want more of the Lord, what do we do with it? Well, first, I would say, look for him, go back to him and look for him. And begin, there's no better place in the Gospels, and look again and discover the Lord Jesus. God said to Moses, you cannot see my face. I will show you my glory, but you cannot see my face. No one can see my face and live. But in Jesus, we have seen the face of God. John tells us that Jesus came and lived for a while among us. And we looked on him and we saw his glory, the glory as of the only Son of God, full of grace and truth. He has shown us himself. And during this season of Lent, as we reflect on the Lord Jesus and the path that he took and where we stand in relation to him, we have seen the glory of God. And as we go deeper into the Lord Jesus, we go deeper into the Lord, and we can want more of him and be satisfied. Be in touch with him. How often do you text the people, the person that you text most often? Well, think of the Lord at least that often. We don't need to text him. No 5G network involved, no monthly charges. Any number of times during the day, think of the Lord. Let him be in our thoughts. Talk to him. In those still watches of the night, when you're anxious, talk to him. Talk to him first and last. Be grateful. Tell him your worries. Just talk to him. Our conversation with the Lord, our thinking of the Lord, need not be restricted to whatever formal time we have set aside. And it need not be restricted to the formal forms of our devotions. But use hymns, use Christian songs to express what you're thinking and feeling. We can do no better than to start with the Psalms and let them, in all of their color, express how we feel. And I advise you to persist. this nearness of God will not necessarily be instant. And it won't necessarily be felt. That same psalmist says, "Have you forgotten us?" It's a long way between Moses' first encounter with God at the burning bush and "Who are you to show me your glory?" Do we really think that David, "My soul earnestly seeks you, God," that just happened overnight? No, persist. Persist. And finally, if we want to go deeper into the Lord, if we want to know more of him, obey him. "If you love me," said Jesus, "you will obey me. And this is my command, that you love one another. If you love me, you will keep my commandments." I'm not talking about the failings. I'm not talking about how I fail and sin and have to go to the Lord in confession and receive his forgiveness. I'm talking about deliberate, willful, "I can do it my way, and the Lord can ride along beside me and we'll do it together." No. To know him, to really know him and love him more and more, means to obey him. And then look forward to his return. Why do we not pray more often for the Lord's return? If we love him so much, shouldn't we want him to come the sooner the better? The Bible finishes with the words, "Come, Lord Jesus, so be it." Let's pray. We worship you, O living God. We don't see you, but our forerunners saw Jesus. And we have your Spirit to bring alive the pages of Scripture. And we have the written testimony of Jesus' life. And we have the experience of the church. And you have been in our lives, among us, and all around us and within us. And we worship you. Help us this morning to want to love you more. Help us to cultivate a desire. No, will you cultivate that desire in us, Spirit of God? But may we open wide the door that you're knocking at and invite you in for a meal. May we want to love you more and more. We pray, Lord, for those who have special need of you. We pray for Janet's mom. We pray for others in crisis. We pray that they would know the very heart of your glory, which is your goodness and your mercy, whatever form that takes. When things are going well for us, we pray for a spirit of gratitude. When things are not going well and we struggle, we ask for a spirit of trust. We pray that we will learn how to pray the Lord's Prayer, "Your will be done." Lord, we confess that with the psalmist we often don't understand. Our souls are downcast. And as we look around and as we confront the reality of death in our lives and in our world, we pray for those who are near the end of life. We pray for those who, for whom time is running out. And we pray that they will know your peace and that you will give them the joy of the prospect of seeing you soon and being with you. We pray for those who are mourning death, loved ones recently taken from them, or years later still mourning that loss. May they know your peace and comfort. May they have courage. Lord, we see death on a massive scale in our world. We confess that we're prone to doubt you in this, but we ask again, we just keep praying that you would act with mercy. We think of the natural disasters in Malawi and in Turkey and Syria after the earthquakes. And where human evil has been unleashed, we pray for justice in places like Ethiopia, but in Ukraine, so present before our eyes. Lord, we ask that you will help us as a congregation to know your will for us, and that we might know your hand upon us, upon our leadership, upon the ministries of this place, upon our role in this community, to be your representatives to point to the God who loves and who is glorious. And we ask, Lord, that you will come back soon. And give us a heart for your return. None of these problems can be solved until you return and establish your kingdom fully and finally. So make us long for your return. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we respond to the message that Ian has just laid before us and God has put in our hearts, we come to an opportunity now for you to share in the ministry of this congregation and the ministry of God's word around and work around the world. If you'd like to, as you leave this morning, there's a plate in the back that you can leave an offering. If you want to do it later, or for those of you that will be watching this on YouTube later, just go to our website, click on Give, and you can follow the links to make a donation there to the life and work of this congregation and all the missionary ministries which we support. Let's bow our head in prayer. Lord, we thank you for Ian's message this morning. We thank you for your graciousness to us. We thank you for all that you've so faithfully given to us. Lord, accept these gifts as just a token of our love, our appreciation for your mercy and all that you have done for us. We ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. As we close our service, I'd invite you to join in the singing of hymn number 416, Christ, of all my hopes, the ground.
Thank you.
Friends, Ian has given us a challenge to reflect, to think, to pray, to meditate on the question, do we really want more of Jesus? I encourage you to do that this coming week. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us now and forevermore. Amen.